This is one of those passages that most preachers, most pastors I know don't want to preach on. Because it basically says if you're divorced and remarried, you're a sinner. And you know what? I'm here to tell you. If you're divorced and remarried, you're a sinner. The same as I am. The same as everybody else is. You can just name your sin. So there. It's out of the way. It's an interesting passage of Scripture that talks about divorce and marriage and adultery and little children. How does that all play together? But before we get to that, I have a story to tell you. This past Wednesday, I got to go to the Door County Adventure Center with a group of 7th graders from Washington Middle School. It was actually a really fun trip. The first thing I got to do with the group of students I was with was do this activity. They were doing all low ropes activities, all things on team building kind of stuff. My first thought when we got there was this would be a great thing for our council to do. I see council members laughing. But they had to do this activity where they had to walk across this wire. It was probably 6 foot from one pole to the next pole. And then from that pole to the next pole was another 6 foot, and then they had an area that was wired off as a triangle. And what they were told is that the land, that they were on an island, and they had to get across to the other island, which was the triangle, and they had to walk across this rope, this wire, to get a rope to help them get the rest of the way across, and they couldn't step in the land. It was actually water, because it's between two islands, right? And it was, if they stepped in the water, there was octopuses or something that would eat their toes. I don't remember exactly what it was. So they're trying to figure this out and going single file, one by one, between these two posts on this little cable. And they get far enough from the post where they have to let go, and what happens? They fall off. They try this over and over again, probably 3 or 4 of them. And finally, their guide said, never said you had to do it alone. So then they asked, so we can have more than one person on the wire. Well, yes, you can have more than one person on the wire. So the next group that went out was probably 4 or 5 girls. And they made it to the post and grabbed the rope, and then they tried to had to figure out how to pass this rope back to the other. But the thing of it is, the 6 that went before them couldn't do it because they were trying to do it on their own. But when they figured out if they worked together as a group, they could reach the post and they could reach the rope. And it was much easier as a group to do what they couldn't do as an individual person. You see, and that's what this passage of Scripture is about today. It takes us back to Genesis chapter 2, which is the second of 2 creation stories, right? Where God creates a helper for man. He's created man, right? In the first creation story, God creates man, male and female. He created them both in his image. But in the second creation story, which is Genesis chapter 2, starting at verse 5, he creates man. And then he tries to create a helper for man, right? And to create a helper for man, he makes all of the animals of the fields, and God brings, can you imagine being Adam and having all of the animals come before you, and you get to name them. But nothing was found for Adam to be a helper for him. So God said that he needed to have a partner. So he caused the sleep to come over him, he opened up his side, took a rib, closed it back up, and then created woman. So that there's a helper for man, right? It's a relationship. Jesus told the Pharisees that they were able to give a letter of divorce because their hearts were hardened, but God created man and woman and joined them together so that the two shall become one, and that they're joined together forever as husband and wife. Because you're created to be in a relationship. The little children tried to come to Jesus, and what did the disciples do? Right? Go away. Because in Jesus' day, what were women and children? What? Seen and not heard. But what were they considered to be?
Property.
Did you catch that, though, in our reading this morning? Jesus said, if a man divorces his wife and marries another, he commits adultery against her. And if a woman divorces her husband, was it possible for a woman to divorce her husband in Jesus' day? No, but Jesus just made them equals. Right? Because it's not man over woman. It's man and woman. We're equal in this, and we're partners in this. That's the thing and the beauty of this passage, because it talks about marriage as a relationship, and it talks about children coming to Jesus, which is a relationship. The children are seeking out God and coming to Him in a relational fashion. I know I've showed this before, but this is my favorite icon. It's actually the only icon that I own. It's Rublev's icon of the Holy Trinity, and it's beautiful in so many ways. It has so much imagery in it, and I think everybody should own it. But it has God the Father with the temple behind Him, God the Son with the tree behind Him, which is where He died, right? He hung on a tree, which is what the cross was made out of. And then we have the Holy Spirit, God the Holy Spirit, with a mountain behind Him, because that's where we go to meet God, is on the mountain. But the beautiful thing about this is you can't really tell the difference between these three pictures. They look pretty much the same. They're all angels. You can't really tell it from back there, but they all have wings. They all have similarities in facial expression, similarities in everything. The thing that I truly love about this, though, is that this shows us that God was created as a relationship in and of Himself. God is three in one and one in three, never separate, never alone. Always in relationship. But the beautiful, most beautiful thing about this is, if you look really close, I'll have that for you so that you can look at it. If you look really close at this, it's a triangle, right? But it's not a triangle because it's actually open at the bottom. And I don't know if Rublev meant to do it this way. I don't know if he intended for this to happen or not. But when I look at this, whether or not Rublev intended it, I see this in this icon. That this is not a closed relationship. And that God Himself is not complete unless you are a part of that relationship. God created each and every one of us to have in us the need to have other people in our lives. Whether that's a spouse, a significant other, children, grandchildren, whatever. We're created to be in a relationship. Because as those seventh graders showed me Wednesday, there are some things that we cannot do by ourselves, no matter how hard we try. And trust me, some of them try really hard to stay on that wire by themselves. It's just not possible to do it. And one last story, completely about relationships this morning. A pastor visited an old member who had not been to church in quite a long time. He went to his house, and they sat at his house in front of a fire. And they sat there in silence for a long time. Finally, the pastor got up after sitting there for the longest time, taking the tongs from the fireplace, took a coal out of the fire, and set it on the hearth. For a while, it burned bright, but then over time, it dimmed, and it got to be the same color as the hearth, a gray. No more fire involved at all. And as the two of them sat there for a little bit, the pastor finally got back up, took that coal, set it back in the fire, and the instant he did, it shot up in flames and became part of that glowing, beautiful fire. Pastor sat down for a few more minutes, got up, got ready to leave, and the member who had not been to church in a while looked at the pastor as he walked out the door and he said, I'll see you Sunday morning, Pastor. None of us can keep our fire going by ourselves. We have to have the body of Christ surrounding us and engulfing us, living in relationships. That's what keeps us moving forward, and that is how God created us to be. Not alone by ourselves, but set ablaze in His body so that everyone will see that fire and see that light and be drawn into the fact that they are also invited into this relationship. That this hole, while small, is still big enough for each and every one of us,
And that's what God wants. He wants us to be involved with Him. He wants us in a relationship with Him. And He's going to do whatever He has to make that happen. So live your lives in such a way that you're connected with the body of Christ, keeping your fire ablaze, knowing that's why you were created, and help others to see that they too can be a part of this beautiful and wonderful thing that we call life with our Lord Jesus.